Okay, so this is the first of two webinars dedicated to the question raised by the application of new artificial intelligence techniques to art and more specifically music. And these two webinars take place within the framework of an event created by the French Consulate in Atlanta and Georgia Tech, and also with the support of the Cultural Service of the French Embassy in the United States. And we are very grateful for all these institutions to make this event possible. It is organized by the Joint Research Laboratory of IRCAM, CNRS, and Sorbonne University, and it is the occasion to invite your US research partner, CNMAT at California University Berkeley, the New York University Music Experience Design Lab, and the Georgia Tech School of Music. The live is broadcasted on YouTube, as you have understood, where you can also ask your question using the chat box. We will try to answer your question during our discussion. Don't hesitate to use the YouTube messagery. There is also a dedicated page where you can find a lot of online resources related to our topics. And we have five speakers today: Carmine Emanuele Cella, composer and professor at CNMAT; Jason Freeman, professor at Georgia Tech; Rémi Mignot, which is a researcher at IRCAM; Nicolas Aubin, researcher at IRCAM and Sorbonne University; and Alex Ruttmann, professor at New York University. I'm Jean-Louis Gianvito, and I will give the speech to Yves Berthelot, which is a pro dean of Georgia Tech for international initiative, and Frank Madlener, the director of IRCAM. So you can switch to Franck or to Yves.
Non, mais à Yves. Peut-être.
Yves.
Yves Berthelot.
So Yves, if you can, I don't know if you are connected because the image is very still. Perhaps waiting the reconnection, Frank, okay. If you can say two words, but perhaps here because the camera, I think.
Yes, it's okay?
Yes.
Now, so I say again that we are happy, I hope we are happy to organize this online event between Atlanta and Paris, especially in this time which are out of joint, time of lockdown or physical distance. We think that it's so important to avoid a cultural gap, cultural territoriality or borders, which have no meaning either for artistic creation, either for science. And in the same time, we do need to think the day after or the year and the decade after. So no border, it has been precisely the IRCAM attitude since its inception with Pierre Boulez 45 years ago. The cross-fertilization between science, art, and engineering does not stay in silo. We are initiating residencies for artistic research with Georgia Tech, and one of the main thematic will be the rise of artificial intelligence in the field of creations. These residencies will allow students exchanges, art science networking between France and United States with university and cultural high place on both continents. So we do need this kind of strong alliance. And alliance means complementarity. So one more word: artificial intelligence and art, AI and emotional feedback. Artificial intelligence is the paradise of the similarity of deep learning. How could it participate it concretely to a creative process? In which way? Human brain is 86 billion neurons. Power consumption 25 watts. What computer can claim in today's hundreds of thousands of processors with colossal energy? Human brain with two or three cases is able to perceive gravitation. The animal is also quite impressive in its capacity to learn. What about machine and deep learning? We are faced with an immense challenging for human creativity, crossing the power of cyber, a creative memory which won't be simple reproduction of the past. I think that one of the most exciting areas for artificial intelligence and music creation is probably the function of fiction for humans, the as if, which is not fake making. A fiction is not the expression of a subject of its personal expression, but the constitution of an artistic world that will provoke expression, habits, coherence, anticipation, results, characteristics, features, everything that we find within the process of artificial intelligence. I leave the floor to the artist and the researcher. I want to thank Jean-Louis Javito in IRCAM, and of course, as you said, the French Embassy for all the support of this meeting.
Thank you very much. Perhaps we can have a word from Yves Berthelot at Georgia Tech. Yes, Yves Berthelot, if you can introduce some word for the seminar. You're dean at Georgia Tech, in charge of international initiative. And perhaps you can have a word about the new convention we have with IRCAM to develop a joint artistic residency.
Yes, thank you so much. I'm really excited to introduce this morning to really a wonderful event, a dialogue between experts on creativity and interactions between humans and machines. This event is part of France Atlanta 2020, which is co-organized by the Consulate General of France in Atlanta and Georgia Tech. We started this series in 2010 to promote innovation and French-American cooperation in science, culture, humanitarian affairs, and business. So this 11th edition presents a very wide range of events, all virtual, of course, because of COVID. And you can find more information if you Google France Atlanta 2020. Just a couple of words first about Georgia Tech. We are a public university. They're proud to be a public university in the United States, ranked number 5 among public universities, and truly one of the leading research universities in the U.S. Georgia Tech provides a technological education to more than 36,000 undergraduates and graduate students. We have strong links with France, in particular through our European hub, our campus of Georgia Tech Lorraine in Metz, where approximately 700 students study every year from Georgia Tech. There are some real natural synergies between Georgia Tech's leading program in music technology, research and education, and of course IRCAM's renowned research enterprise and artistic presentations, education outreach programs. And I'm really thrilled to see that Georgia Tech and IRCAM are now actively engaged in joint research, artistic work, and events. This webinar is one of the examples of this ongoing collaboration, which I'm sure will blossom. And there's many things being discussed, visits and collaborations that really will benefit not only our institutions, but our students and researchers. So again, really excited to hear the seminar today, and I'll leave the microphone to the next speaker. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Okay, thank you very much, and we will start the core of our topics. As a first fact, we can all agree that music touches our mind, our soul, it gives us pleasure, makes us think, and strike us emotionally. So in this picture, what could be the role of AI in music then? Is there a place, a room for AI? Can AI draw inspiration from music? Or can music offer insight for humans in the way of AI works? Can music help reconcile AI technology with human priorities and needs? The conversation with our guests will reflect on these topics. But first, I want to listen to short excerpts of music produced by AI techniques. We first listen and then I comment and I will ask some questions. If you can just...
I switch for
Okay. Il n'y a pas de son? Sorry. Okay, this example is an example of chorale made by a computer using rules in the late 80s on a theme by Jean-Sébastien Bach. And it was the work of Kemal Ebicioglu. And that was the old way of approaching AI techniques using expert knowledge. Now we are more on deep learning and numerical machine learning, which is fancier. And here is an example by David Cope. For mimicking some piece of Mahler. So I want to switch screen, and I can ask my first question for the composer and music teacher in our speakers. Is it good? Are you interested by these two pieces? And if yes or no, why? And the question behind is, as a composer, why using AI in music? For what? For what purpose? To fulfill which need? And perhaps we can ask to Carmine Emanuele Cella, your professor, composer and computer scientist at California University at Berkeley. And you develop, amongst many other things, Orchidea, which is an automated system for orchestration. What is your feelings about these two examples? Carmine, I think you have to open the mic.
Ouais.
Okay.
It's okay. Thank you.
No. No.
No. We lost your voice.
Okay. Do you hear me?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay. So I was saying, hello, everybody. Thanks for inviting me. I'm very glad to be here. And so, thanks, Jean-Louis, for your question. I'm not sure how to approach the question. In my experience as a composer and a researcher, if you wish, I had different moments in which I wanted to use technology for my own work, and in other moments I didn't want to use technology in my own work. Regarding your question about the examples, I'm not sure if I can say if this was like Mahler-like music or not. What I think is that both the examples that you showed us are example of a specific process that happens in the symbolic space. Like both of your examples have been generated by machines that were learning like MIDI information, symbolic information. And so like the Bach's chorale is an example of that. I mean, in the 80s, people were able to regenerate Bach's, you know, melodies or Bach's chords using Markov models. And this was applied to a symbolic representation. It's a MIDI representation. Then you played an example in which, you know, David Cope generated Mahler-like music or something like that. And then in that case, I suppose this was also generated on using MIDI as a basic representation for musical information. So my whole point as a composer does not happen in the pitch space per se. It happens in the timbre space. So as such, any kind of utility and any kind of, you know, tools that just help me to handle the pitch space is not at the center of my reflection as a composer. In other words, my musical thinking happened in the timbre space, not in the symbolic space. So being able to represent MIDI notes is something that is not so central for me. So I'm not sure if I say anything else about these two examples that you played, but in my opinion, I think that the game became much more interesting when machines became able to handle timbre or timbre representations in some sense. And that's what's happening today somehow with deep learning to some degree. But still, I am not sure if these machines are useful for me as a composer. I don't know if it answers your question, so Henry.
At least they give some element of reflection. And for the question of timbre, we will come back again later in this seminar, because you have worked with machine on timbre, so perhaps you can add something at this moment. But now, Jason Freeman, you're a professor of music at Georgia Tech and chair of the School of Music. And as a composer and as a teacher, is it interesting? Are the examples here interesting? Do you give this example to a classroom, for instance?
Yeah, it's really interesting that you bring up these examples. Literally, just yesterday in class, I'm teaching a graduate course this fall on the history of electronic music, and we were looking at Cope's M.E. Mahler work literally just yesterday and talking about it with my students. And some of my students made a really interesting point that I want to pass on to the panelists here today. And that is that, you know, they're not questioning kind of the goal or the intent, and they're impressed by the technology that enables these, you know, these fairly compelling imitations of Mahler, or in the case of the other example you played of Bach. But it's not, they didn't find it interesting at the end of the day, because it was simply trying to kind of recreate and imitate styles of the past. They pointed out how, you know, perhaps for an introductory music theory student, something like this might be an interesting, you know, kind of approach to try to learn how to imitate things that we already know and imitate the work of another composer and their style. But as you grow as a composer and a musician, you obviously want to find your own voice and your own kind of unique take on things. And that's where I think that, you know, both of these examples kind of fall short of that goal in terms of my own interest as an educator and as an artist. Though I think that quote that you shared on the second slide with the David Cope example points towards that role, this role that the computer can play as a provocateur, as a collaborator with a composer, with a musician, challenging them and pushing them to try new things and go in new directions. And that's really where I see the excitement and the potential here, whether it's in the symbolic space or it's in the temporal space, wherever it might be. And I think we've actually seen some good examples of this with some more recent deep learning examples, particularly things in the commercial world that are really working as collaborators with artists and pushing them towards trying new things rather than just kind of recreating things that have come before or trying to.
Okay, thank you. And Alex Ruttmann, you're associate professor of music education and music technology. And you're also the director of the New York University Music Experience Design Lab. So what's your first reaction about these two examples? Okay, it seems that Alex is disconnected. I don't know if you hear me, Alex, just to reconnect them. And meanwhile, perhaps we can go a little bit further. Jason, you mentioned that... Alex, no, yes. Jason, you mentioned that, in fact, you see some kind of challenge on pushing motivation in the what the computer is able to do. And in fact, if we look at what has said David Kopp, it was initially motivated because it was unable to work on an opera. And it has developed the first musical system, AMI, just to help him to feel again some sensation about his own style, with the idea that it will push him to produce new materials. At the end of the day, in fact, his system was so attractive that he made his system a real musician, and there is recorded music and published under the name of the system. So the idea that the system is not for public use, or as not to produce things, but just as a kind of motivation for the composer, was lost in the process, and the machine was promoted to a full composer view. And perhaps can you elaborate on that, Carmine? Do you think that artificial intelligence has to act as a kind of composer replacement, that is the replacist or the substitutive approach of AI? Or do you believe that there is some kind of of virtue in AI to use it as a kind of companionship, as a musical companion to explore new area, new venue? It seems to me that a lot of effort in AI are done by computer scientists that want to compose in place of a composer. So, but there is a room for the composer to use the machine only as a tool or as a companion, but not as a replacement of himself.
You know, when you start discussing AI for creativity, it's sort of a polarizing argument. So you say something, and then someone else is somehow on a different, you know, has a different perspective, as it should. But point is that whatever you say, it's really a slippery terrain. So I'm not sure how to handle this kind of discussions in principle. So the only thing I can give you is my experience, like my experience both as a composer and again as the researcher. And so I don't think that anybody wanted to develop machines to replace composers or artists in general. I believe that there are two main reasons to develop tools for musical creativity. One is just because it's fun. Like researchers have fun in thinking that they can develop machines that are somehow creative. I am a researcher myself, and I know what it means. Like I understand that when you see this machine giving you something that you didn't expect, it feels fun, it feels nice. And then, you know, there is a critical thinking that comes from my activity as a composer that tries to minimize the outcomes of these tools. And you know, as a composer, it's very hard to accept a machine to do your job somehow. So in my personal experience, I unfortunately, I didn't really find yet anything that is really useful enough for me during my work. I have used at many tools, many computational, you know, tools for helping me during the compositional phase. But this is just, again, I use them as a tool, like as something that is, you know, in a larger context. So my musical thinking is not shaped by this tool most of the time, but my process speeds up when I use these tools. So you mentioned Orchidea is a tool for assisted orchestration or computer assisted orchestration. So the idea behind this tool is just you have a sound defined in some sort of, you know, timbre space or feature space, and then you want to approximate this sound using musical instruments. And so these tools, you know, tries to find combinations of instruments that sound like the target sound, the original sound. And so this is interesting as a composer. But I don't expect this tool to give me the score of my music or the final product of my music. I use this as an intermediate step of my creational process, so that I can base my work on some inputs that come from these tools. So to make the long story short, I don't know. I think it's very difficult to answer your question, but probably for me, at least as a personal, just my personal experience, I believe that the musical thinking, the critical thinking that I have as a composer is much, much stronger than the outcomes of the machines. For now, at least, I've discussed many times with other composers, for example, with a close friend, is Daniele Ghisi, that used neural networks for sound generation. And so I don't think that anybody really thinks that machines will replace composers by any mean. But maybe there is good hope to think that maybe these machines will help your work as a composer, and will speed up your work to some extent. That's somehow my answer to this question.
Thank you. I don't know, Alex, are you online now? No, still no. So perhaps Jason, Carmine just pointed that his musical thinking is not affected by the machine. Is it the same case for you, or do you think it can be interact or have some impact?
Yeah, that's a really good question. And first, I want to highlight something that Carmine just pointed out, which is this distinction, I think, between what we would think of as computer-composed music, where the computer is kind of acting autonomously. We throw a bunch of data of past compositions at it, and it spits out a bunch of new compositions, versus computer-aided composition, which is really more about this way that a composer works with the computer as a tool, no matter whether it's using deep learning or whatever else there might be involved, but using it as a tool to assist in the composition process, and to kind of help shape and generate ideas, but plays a very different role, not that same level of autonomy. And I think that's a really important distinction to make. The idea of computer-composed music is even older than computers. We can go back to the 1950s and the RCA Corporation trying to create analog devices to compose kind of commercial jingles. And we see companies now trying to do the same thing, largely because of royalty questions. And this question of, well, can we throw in some automated music for YouTube videos or wherever else we might need it that's devoid of intellectual property by having a computer compose it. So there are kind of needs for that, but we've never kind of gotten over that hump where that's become a mainstream activity. But the like Carmine, I don't really tend to use AI in my compositional practice in significant ways. The way that we're talking about composition. But I think there's another way that it is incredibly valuable and important, and that's when we think about new kinds of musical instruments and modes of expression and of musical performance. Because there we have a very particular problem that AI is really good at solving, which is about recognizing gesture and solving mapping problems, where we have gazillions of sensors and data that are coming into a system in real time, and we're trying to make sense of all that to create something that's expressive and also somewhat mysterious, that is instantly kind of accessible to someone who might pick it up and try to play with it, but rewards deep practice and continued interaction as well. And it turns out that work of people like Rebecca Fibrink is a great example of this, with her work in this space. That machine learning and now deep learning as well are incredibly powerful tools to help us accomplish those goals, to create these subtle and expressive and sophisticated performance interfaces for music. That's really where it's interesting to me as a composer and artist.
Can I jump in, Jean-Louis?
Yeah, sure.
Please. I just wanted to react to what Jason just said. I totally agree with that. Like, the idea of human-computer interaction is an essential aspect of my work as a composer. Indeed, I believe that, I was recently thinking my whole life as a composer, and I was trying to understand which impact machines had in this life. And so in this thinking, I realized there are three major things that I use computers for. during my musical during my musical life. One, and they somehow summarized into three words that are very, very simple: analysis, synthesis, and human-computer interaction. So I wanted to use computers to analyze music to understand more. I wanted to use computer to synthesize music, or helping me in synthesizing music. And as Jason pointed out, in my case, it's almost of the time, in a sense of computer-assisted composition or computer-aided composition. So this was my interpretation of analysis of synthesis. Sorry. And then there is the third aspect of computers in my work that is exactly what Jason mentioned: human-computer interaction. Like, when I design any algorithm, I need to compose with it. So composability, if you see what I mean, is an essential property of these machines, so that I can put these machines into a context in which humans and machines interact. And that's essential, I mean, in any kind of aspect. Because you write music for humans, or because you just generate sounds that are humans use as you know, as listeners. So this aspect of interaction with a machine is indeed very, very important for me too.
Okay, thank you. And perhaps a way to have a bigger picture is also that we have focused a little bit on the interaction between composer and artificial intelligence. But music or artificial intelligence can do other things. For example, in musical education, playing music or composing music needs a lot of learning here. Can AI technique change the game? Can it help? And I know that Alex at New York, but Jason in Georgia Tech, you have developed the tools and environment to help the learning of music. I don't know if Alex is online, but if not, Jason, can you tell us a little bit about EarthSketch? And
yeah, I'd be happy to, but I'm checking first to see if Alex is there.
I am here. I don't know whether it's coming through. But
yeah, we can hear you, Alex.
Sure. Okay. So I'll just come in briefly. I mean, my work is with education and designing tools for learning. And particularly working with novices and with children, and more and more, you know, the largest educator in the world today is youth, and students spend more time creating and learning away from a formal classroom or studio setting. And this is really, I think, the potential for a lot of the AI, as described by Jason and Carmine, to be that creative partner, is a place, as tools that's there to support a student's musical thinking. And that's why originally I'm not so interested in the products of AI as were originally shared in the opening here, but really AI is a tool to help the process of learning, the process of asking questions of musical repertoire, of providing tools for kids to theorize about the music that they're curious about, and to create and to learn and to generate creative possibilities. And so that's been guiding a lot of the work in my lab in designing technologies that are simpler and make music open and tangible in a playful way, so that we can learn from AI applications, analyses of corpus, to be able to look at musical dimensions and to bring that in. So this is where I'm my perspective is on AI, and I'm going to pass the mic back to Jason, and then I'll come back in later.
Okay, so Jason, if you want to present, I can...
Sure, that'd be great. Broadcast. If you can pull up those couple of slides there.
Yeah.
A screenshot of it here. It's a web-based learning platform for students generally in the age range of about 10 to 18 years old. And it's designed for introductory computer science courses. The first time they're learning how to code, first time they're learning about computer science. And our intention here is to integrate music into that experience to increase engagement by students in both computing and in music technology, and to increase the diversity of the students that are participating in these experiences and that want to continue learning in both of those fields. And so the interface was designed to look somewhat like a music production environment, like GarageBand or Pro Tools or Ableton Live or something like that. There's a sound library that comes with it, with sounds and popular music genres made by well-known artists. And then you write code in either the Python or JavaScript a programming language to actually place these audio clips and effects and automations and things like that onto a multi-track timeline to make your own song by building these, built out of these existing clips and any other things you might want to upload to the platform. And we've used this and done a lot of research projects across a lot of different learning contexts, different age groups, formal and informal education, and so on. And we've seen over and over again, this has some real power to increase student engagement in computer science and in music technology. The students really love this, that it's tied to their sense that it's authentic and relevant to their lives outside the classroom. It mirrors these kind of music production paradigms. It's involving music and artists and styles of music that they care about, and it has an impact on students regardless of their gender or their racial background or their socioeconomic background or their level of experience in music or computer science before they take these courses. So these are great series of research findings, and we've scaled up this product. It's used by over 500,000 students now have used Your Sketch to learn computer science, both in the United States and beyond. So we were noticing, though, a kind of persistent problem here, which is that in a typical classroom context, there's only one teacher, and there's usually about 30 students. And so it's very hard for students to get that just-in-time help they need. And partially because of that, and also because of some other factors, students were sometimes getting into ruts, either musically or computationally, just doing the same things over and over and over again. They needed something to kind of push them out of that, to provoke them, going back to that David Cope quote at the beginning of our panel today, to get them to try new things and kind of move outside of their comfort zones. And so what we've done is we've built this tool called CAI, Co-Creative Artificial Intelligence. And this is with a number of collaborators at Georgia Tech as well as the University of Florida. And we have a very early prototype. This is not in public release yet. We're doing our first tests in the next couple of weeks with real students to see how it works. But it shows up in the right sidebar here. It looks like a chat bot, basically, where you get natural language coming from this environment, and then you can send messages back to it. But what it's doing in the background is it's analyzing the code that students are writing. It's analyzing the music that they're creating. It's using a huge database of kind of what it knows about how students code in this EarSketch platform and the kinds of learning objectives that we have, the things we want them to try. And it's giving them suggestions, a new sound to try, a new musical transition to try, a place to use a for loop or to define a new function. All these fundamental concepts the goal is to kind of push students the same way that, kind of a peer that knows just a little bit more than they do might try, making gentle suggestions, providing some scaffolding and some tips for how to try things, and engaging in this dialogue about how to make the music better, how to make the project better. So this is a project we're really excited about and a real role that we see for AI in this education space.
Thank you, Jason. It's something very puzzling in what we show here is that there is some kind of dialogue between the artificial intelligence and the user, and it seems that it implies that the machine is capable of evaluating and characterizing a music piece. Is it good? Is it bad? Is it interesting? Do you have in which direction you have to go? And it means that the machine must be able to get some kind of the semantic of music, making some judgment. And this give me some question to Rémi. Rémi, you do research about audio indexing and classification, which is known as MIR, Music Information Retrieval in computer science. You do that at the STMS lab. Can you describe us the way to go from the raw signal to a more semantic understanding of music? What can be achieved? What is still unsolved? What are the challenges in this area? Does AI disrupt the field, and in which way? And I will put your slide. That's here.
So first, I will explain shortly my research. So I work on music information retrieval, and so to summarize, the aim is to start from an audio recording and to estimate some musical information, such as the musical keys, the tempo, the musical genre of the song, and the emotion which is felt by the listener. And also, for example, we can compute some similarities between sounds. And between this input audio file and this musical information, we have the processing, which runs on the computer, and it is based on signal processing and, of course, artificial intelligence. So the question is how to start from the signal to the musical information. Then first, we have to do a representation of the signal. Jean-Louis, please. Okay. So in the upper part of the figure, we have the standard waveform representation, which is the value of the sound pressure over the time. But it is not relevant usually for our analysis. So we derive a time frequency representation. So it is represented on the lower part of the figure. Then the horizontal axis is still the time. And now we have a decomposition of the frequency component over the vertical axis. And this kind of representation is, Jean-Louis, can you play this song?
Sorry.
So this representation is very interesting because in this example, we can see two different patterns. First, we can see vertical lines, and they represent percussive sounds. And we also see parallel and horizontal lines, and they represent the tones. For example, the notes. Here, it's a trumpet. We have three sustained notes and some short melody. And so with this kind of representation, we can compute acoustic features and we can exhibit some patterns in order to make some estimation on the sound. So for example, by analyzing the evolution on time of these components, we can have some information about the rhythm. Then we can infer the tempo and the rhythmic key. And with the horizontal line, we can have some information about the tone, and then we can estimate the harmonic key, the chords, and also the transcription. And also, we can combine these different features, and we can estimate more complex information, such as the genre and the mood. So now, just to summarize how the computer can exhibit the suitable features and how it can combine them in order to get the wanted information. So just we have a lot of different approaches, but here I summarize them by two opposite approaches. In the first time, we have an expert algorithm. It is based on a prior knowledge of the wanted, of the link between the signal and the wanted information. And so we design some dedicated algorithm with a signal processing tool in order to get this musical information. For example, we have an efficient algorithm for the tempo and the tone estimation, at least with a single note. And but for other tasks with a very complex information, such as the musical genre of the emotion, it's very difficult to make a strong hypothesis about this link. So we used learning, supervised learning, and we build a data collection. I mean, that's a collection of a lot of data with pairs of input and corresponding outputs, and then the computer will automatically learn the link between the audio recording and the wanted information. So that's very interesting because we now the knowledge of the information we want to estimate is not explicitly detailed, but it's implicitly included inside the dataset. But for your question about if AI has disrupted the work, actually in musical information retrieval, we have used AI for some decades, but for some years, the deep learning has changed a lot of things because it's very powerful. It has a very good flexibility and the optimization processes are very interesting. So it has improved a lot of things for some years, for some tasks. And so we are starting and continuing to work with AI and of course deep learning.
Okay, Remy, but in your tool schema, I see a potential problem in the fact that the machine is a little bit autistic. For example, it evaluates the music, but from the recording in the input alone. But for a music, for example, being sad or frightening or happy, it seems to me that it's very linked to the receptors of the information, the auditors, the guy that is listening to music, and that's very subjective. And it also depends of history of music is not coming out of the blue just now, but it's written in some long development over the years. So do you believe that this social dimension of the music and the memorial dimension of the music can be handled by machine?
For now, my work is only descriptive application. We start from the performance, which is encoded by the audio recording, and we deduce the score or the emotion felt by the listener. So it's not at all a conversation. We learn the link between this different agent, but only from the transmitter to the receiver. So it's not a conversation, not yet, but it can be interesting, yes, to make at least a kind of inverse transmission. For example, given the emotion of the listener, maybe we can guide the music creation in order to make a music with the emotion which is felt by the listener. Why not?
Okay. Carmine, I know that you are relying a lot on music descriptors to help a composer to orchestrate a piece of music, which implies perhaps that there are some descriptors that are able to catch the timbre of music and not only speech. Can you give us a few words about the Orchidea system and the way you are working with and the role of this tool is in the composer workflow?
Sure. I believe that descriptors, audio descriptors, have played a big role in the MIR community for a number of years now. The idea behind descriptors is that you want to find a representation, or as we say today, an embedding of a sound into a space that is meaningful for some reasons. Like, for example, you want to describe the brightness of the sound, or you want to describe the other qualities that are perceptual qualities of the sound. Orchidea uses descriptors to perform assisted orchestration, but the recent iteration of this system, that is named actually Orchidea, works on a different principle than previous iterations. So the idea behind previous iteration was to embed sounds in a low-dimensional feature space using a small number of features that were kind of percentually related. For example, spectral centroid that is related to brightness and other measures that you can somehow describe as perceptual features. The idea behind the new iteration, Orchidea, is somehow has been motivated by the rise of neural networks in the recent, 5 to 7 years. And so now the idea is to use a high-dimensional feature space in which features are not directly related to perception. And we use a high-dimensional embedding, and then the machine tries to optimize this embedding towards some specific, you know, scope or objective that you wanna discover. So in other words, I believe that also in assisted orchestration, the deep learning and the recent, you know, developments in machine learning affected a little bit the methodology. Difference between Orchidea, for example, and neural networks is that Orchidea is still made of a number of steps that usually rely on our understanding of the problem. So it's not meant to be an end-to-end system, as we say today, so a system that, you know, given a sound, gives you something as an output, but indeed is made of a number of, you know, components. Some of them are indeed neural networks. But these components are somehow led and designed using our understanding of the problem, that is musical orchestration. Orchestration is a very complicated issue because it involves many difficult to formalize components, for example, timbre, for example, perception. So until now, there was not, there is not yet today a way to describe in a formal way orchestration. So it's made by, you know, tradition, basically. So a teacher teaches and a student how to orchestrate something. So to encode this information into a software is not easy. So features, as we were discussing, are an important part of this system, but are not the only part. You know, so we have a feature-based representation, but this representation is handled by a number of other, you know, technologies and tools that are meant to somehow outline a full workflow for orchestration. To answer the second question you asked me, how you integrate this tool into a composer or composition workflow, well, this is really dependent on the composer, I suppose. And Orchidea has been used in many different ways. So there is a quite big community behind the software now. The user base is growing, and I'm very happy to see that many institutions and universities as well use this tool for pedagogic application, for example. There is not a single way to use computer-assisted tools for a composer. So again, I would speak for myself. I would speak for my own experience. And so the way I do use Orchidea in my work, not always, but often. And the way I do that is just I usually, as I was mentioning before, my musical thinking is not a pitch-based musical thinking; it's a timbre-based musical thinking. So basically, what I usually do is I imagine a timbre, and then I try to recreate this timbre using sounds or files or, you know, recordings or whatever sounds or synthesis, and then this would be a good descriptor for my musical idea. And then I would use Orchidea to derive some musical parameters from this description. So, in other words, suppose you imagine some sort of musical situation, then you try to mimic this situation using real sounds, real files or recordings, and then you would use Orchidea to derive some, you know, instrumentation from these acoustic description. This is just the beginning of my compositional process, or it's an intermediate step. It's not the whole thing. And so the musical development and the musical thinking is just, you know, independent from Orchidea. But Orchidea is a good tool that helps me to speed up somehow the compositional process. But I know that there are other composers that use this tool in a very different way. For example, they just use the sounds. They don't use the scores that Orchidea creates. There are other composers that just need some inspiration, and then they don't use the solutions proposed by Orchidea, but they use this solution as a mean to create new solutions, if you wish, so to basically compose. So it's really depending on the aesthetics, the poetics, and the methodology that each artist actually has.
Okay, perhaps I can give you some example to give some flesh to your explanation. Here is a target song, and I will make listen the corresponding orchestration. No. Okay, it's a girl screaming, and what the orchestral counterpart. Okay, another natural song. So raindrops on the orchestration. What I find fascinating with your approach is that you avoid the need to define what is, on a formal level, an orchestration. You are using target, and you use in which way the machine is strong, that is making some kind of imitation. And that's exactly the approach taken by Alan Turing, when he doesn't want to define formally what is intelligence. He says it's too difficult, but I can recognize what is intelligence. So I can imitate an intelligent behavior, even if I don't be able to define it. So perhaps we have to use artificial intelligence for what is it best, the imitation. Imitation for a composer is seen as a bad behavior, but we have seen here as a kind of détournement of the system to use imitation for creative purposes. So, Nicolas Aubin, your researcher at IRCAM, at STMS Lab, your professor at Sorbonne University, you can tell us a lot about imitation because you are synthesizing voice, and we have some slides so you can explain what is imitation for you, and can we imitate? So, yes. If we switch screen, please, Eric. Okay.
So yeah, can you hear me?
Yes.
Yeah, okay. So hi, I'm Nicolas Aubin. I'm working at IRCAM and associate professor at Sorbonne University. Hello, everyone, and I'm glad to be there with you for this event. So maybe the one with the less musical background in my research today at IRCAM, because I'm not working with music or musical composition. I'm working with speech synthesis, speech transformation, and everything related to the recreation, the artificial recreation or the manipulation of speech and of singing voice as well, but it's more on the side of my research. So as you know today, you probably know the term deepfake, which has been prominent over the last 2 years maybe, or even more. And so today we are able to simulate the reality with a very high level of realism or credibility that have never been reached before. Especially this simulation have been applied to mimics or imitate human behavior, and production, such as speech synthesis. So you know maybe the works by Google and all of these big companies. We have developed extreme realistic speech synthesizers, like Tacotron, for instance, or Deep Voice. And even more with virtual reality, in which now we are the humans are in immersion with these new simulated worlds. So so you know Tacotron and all this deepfake software, which are freely available today. So maybe we can go to the next slide. So it's just a fact. And we have applied, wait a minute, yeah. We have applied this, we had a lot of demand over the last decade from artists and TV broadcast production to recreate the voice of past personalities. So that's what we did on this example. It was from the artist Philippe Parreno in 2012, and we recreated with the help of an actress the voice of Marilyn Monroe for this short.
In the opposite corner, there is a mirror. Under the mirror, on a console table, there is a copy of a small Rodin sculpture of a nude woman, a black telephone, and a perfume bottle. In the corner, on a teak tray card, a transistor radio, portable tape deck, and an arrangement of golden yellow lilies and white roses. And there is a record player on the floor.
So yeah, that was a short excerpt from the short movie by Philippe Parreno, which is actually 20 minutes. And so that was back in 2012, and it was quite super realistic at this time. So that's okay. Now we can simulate speech and a lot of other modalities of human behaviors extremely realistically. But you can go to the next slide then. Yeah, without playing.
I can stop.
Yeah, okay. So that's fascinating, of course, because now we can simulate human behaviors. But for an artistic point of view, maybe it can be a limitation, because as the guy said before, especially Carmine and the others, imitation is not creation. So we need to find a way to use this AI things in a more creative process. So I ask a question here. So maybe the composer can react after. Is the artist the first or the original forger in the history? I remind like it was the artist Giotto, who was named by Dante as an artist, and we was the first person who was able to mimic or to simulate the reality, even more realistic than the reality. So, and that's a question I wanted to ask. And here we have an example of the use of the technologies, text-to-speech, for instance, in a creative way by the composer, the French composer Georges Apergis. And who didn't use the text-to-speech as it, but he tried to make some manipulation or to use in different ways, which are not humanly realistic, but creatively interesting.
Okay, perhaps we can listen.
Yeah.
C'est pas mis de dire que tu es que. Chartons deux fois que des milliers vesca, chartons deux de là, chartons trois
agents s'arrêtent. Tire droit. Toute prudence. Allez, l'instant même si. Un peu gauche, sous sa figure, un peu chez elle, sous son visage. Arrêtez.
Okay, so here we have the use of technology, not only for imitation, but it is used to transform the voice. It is also used for gesture following.
Exactly, yeah.
And some also video manipulation.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay.
So the question I have here is that the function of the artist, these technologies like AI or artificial intelligence, question the role or the function of the artist. Is it just to simulate or recreate the reality, or is it to transfigure it, or to create new alternative realities? As Frank said in this introduction, creation is not imitation, and it's not individual expression, it's anticipation of the future, such as fictions or science fictions is. And so the artist may be the one who express, although it's a citation from an unknown artist, the artist is, the function is to express his own representation and to impose them to the face of the world, so as a new credible reality. So, and at the end, I have another question. So can AI be creative? So, and in what sense and for what purpose? So that's a very fundamental question that we can raise now, and that was partially answered by Carmine and the others. So I had just a reaction in opposition with what Carmine said before. He said that he did not expect the artificial intelligence to replace the composer, and maybe literally he said that to take his job. And so we don't know actually. In the past, artificial intelligence have been proved to overpass human in many tasks. So in symbolic tasks, for instance, to play chess games or the Go games as well. But it's still a very specific task. And human, you know, simulating the creativity of human is not only maybe for fun, but it's in the attempt of a researcher or humans or the dream of humans to be able to reproduce artificially a human. And now the artificial intelligence can solve very specific tasks, but it's super specific, and it does not englobe all of the cognitive function that humans have. And in my opinion, creativity is one of the most fascinating cognitive skills of humans, and maybe through musical composition is a good point to question the creativity of humans, and why do we need to create and for what purpose? So maybe the composer can try to answer.
Yes, perhaps the rest of the speaker can answer to that, because I think that a lot of computer scientists are talking about creative computers. But it seems to me that the word creative is much less used by the artist. So perhaps it points some question or some problems. If you want to react, and then we take the question from internet.
Can I react?
Yes, please.
Since Nicolas, you know, brought me into the game. So thanks, Nicolas, for your question. Let me clarify somehow what I said before. So your questions are many questions, so I'll try to address some of them. So the first thing is that I'm not sure that the dream of humans is to make machines replace humans. This is kind of a general statement that you gave, and I'm not sure this is somehow interesting. Maybe it's not interesting for me. But that said, I don't think that for me as a composer, so like, knowing if a machine can replace a composer is not a composer's question for me. Like when I compose, I never ask myself, what is creativity? I just use it. And this means that I have not this meta-reflection on the act of creation, because I just try to do creation. That is something that passes through a number of channels that are not formalized in my mind. So in other words, I don't think about creativity when I use creativity. I just use it. And in fact, most of the times I'm not aware of what I'm doing when I compose. Like many things are not a sequence of logic steps. And that's why I believe I don't ask myself if a machine could replace my work. I don't think it's even an important question for me. Probably, yes, you're right. You know, I remember when IBM made Deep Blue and people were saying, you know, it's not possible to win chess against, you know, the masters. And in fact, they won. Like Deep Blue won the chess game against the masters. So I think that, yes, if you do enough research, if you take enough computational time, if you take some time of research, then maybe you can approximate very well a problem. And then eventually you can do better than humans. But is this a relevant outcome for humans? Like, I'm not sure I want to know if a machine can replace me as a human. So my compositional work is an aspect of my being a human. And so I don't know. I don't see the research going towards the direction for myself. I understand from a research perspective that it could be interesting to see to which extent we can imitate humans. And maybe if machines can actually do something that humans cannot do, as they can eventually. But it's a kind of a meta question. So it's a researcher's question. It's not a composer's question, in my opinion. In my opinion, a composer just does what he can do, and is writing music. And then I don't ask myself if a machine can do better than me or faster than me. That's why my previous statements, so I said two things that I'd like to clarify. One, I said that it's fun. It was not meant to be negative. I mean, I know that fun is one of the engine of research, like seeing what you can do with your research and to which extent you can go. It's an important, you know, aspect of research. I mean, at least I think this is for me the case. So fun is good. And I think that it makes total sense for scientific research to pursue and try to imitate or replicate or replace eventually human creativity. But for me as a composer, this is not a central question in my work. I don't ask myself if I can use a machine to replace myself, you know, if you see what I mean. It's a kind of a meta question. And indeed, what also Frank said at the beginning, that, you know, it's not about imitation, it's about creation. And also Jason resonates on that. You know, I remember that he said that his students pointed out that this Cope's imitation of Mahler was not a creative thing. It was just, you know, a copy of things. So also to this point, I would say imitation is part of creation. I would say that there are, you know, imitation and purification are two major forces of creation since always, even in Greek tragedy. You know, the idea of mimesis and catharsis are two important ideas of artistic creation. So you can copy reality or you can transfigurate reality and create symbols of reality. And this is a artistic creation in itself. So I don't think that being very good at imitate something is a point, but maybe it is. So it depends on the artistic point of view. For example, in myself, I see myself as an artist that is mostly cathartic. I don't think about music as an imitation. I think about music as a transfiguration. So this kind of approach is larger than machines, if you see what I mean, because I don't look for a machine to transfigurate this would mean that machines would be doing my work. And I don't look for that. I try to look for machines that can help me to apply my transfiguration, if you see what I mean. So in other words, I think that this is an interesting question, and I believe that probably to some extent machine could replace composers, But I don't think this is a composer's question, if you see what I mean.
Yeah. Okay, thank you, Alex. Jason, do you want to react? Do you have some things? And then we take we have several questions.
Yeah, I can just very quickly, this conversation reminded me of a quote, a favorite quote of mine, which I just looked up and I thought I would share for what it's worth. This is from Bill Buxton, who is a very famous user interface designer and researcher. And he wrote a while ago, this is in the 90s, he wrote this, but he said, I discovered that in the grand scheme of things, there are three levels of design: standard spec, military spec, and artist spec. Most significantly, I learned that the third, that's the artist spec, was the hardest and most important. But if you could nail it, then everything else was easy. And there's a lot to unpack in that statement there. And it's not about AI, it's about design. But I think there's a lot that we can take over to this conversation we're having about AI and creativity in the arts. That there is something fundamentally different and more challenging about trying to have our artificial intelligence create. And you know, there are questions about whether that's the right goal that we should be after. And I agree with a lot of what Carmine just said. But I think that there's also a lot to be learned from understanding why this problem is so hard to begin with. And I think through that, we can not only come up with new ways to merge artificial intelligence and music creation and performance, but I think we can also find new ways that through that exploration, we can push the field of artificial intelligence more generally forward. I think there is a reason that so many people, so many researchers are so interested in music as a domain for AI. And there's a lot to learn from the reason for that interest and the reason for its challenge.
But is it a good thing for the music? Because, music to push the AI, but does it have some gain in music?
I think there will always be gains in ways that we cannot yet predict. I agree that looking at this notion that the AI replaces the composer is an overly simplistic kind of a viewpoint, even though it's one that we've stuck with for 70 years for whatever reason in terms of how we think about this in popular culture. But I think, looking at those points where they can come together and they can help each other is really where the interest lies.
Okay, Alex, do you want to?
And I would, I would say that the most interesting thing about AI is its potential to get more people creating and composing. One of the biggest barriers that our kids face is that our software presents a blank screen. And our interfaces are designed that way because they're what a professional needs with all that space to put on there. And if we can instead focus on designing interfaces where kids can ask questions of their favorite music, of being able to more explore their intuitive creativity and start creating at an earlier age, then we will see more artistic creation. We will see more come from that. So to me, it's really this bringing these tools and democratizing them down to the youngest ages where they can, seed ideas, play around with them. And for me, I also have a background as a former school teacher, and my students wanted nothing more than to play directly with the songs and the music that they loved. And with computational MIR algorithms and remixing and the possibilities that are out there, we now can create tools for kids to play directly with the cultural artifacts they value, pick them apart, ask questions of them, learn about the musical thinking, and then start creating from that. And there's so many barriers to professional practice and with tools that now on our mobile phones, we can develop AI music creation environments so that anybody can start playing around. And yes, it's a continuum. Yes, there's professional capital A artistic practice, and we need all of this high level research for, but there's a lot of things that we leave on the lab table that could be adapted that might not have fit our need for feature classification because it wasn't at a high enough percentage, but that barrier, that difference between 70% accuracy and 100% accuracy actually can help when we're trying to give students more opportunities to find new creative possibilities in the interfaces. So I look at AI as this really great space for getting more people creating if we push it in that direction.
Okay, thank you. I think it's more than time to stop our discussion. We have some questions from the internet. The first, I propose that we spend 10 more minutes to try to answer it. The first one is easy to answer. Someone asks, machine can look into the neuroactivity of my brain. While I listen music, my brain activity show me good intonation, good timbre. Can deep learning understand it and make for people new music? I propose not to answer this question because if you come back tomorrow, you will have one of our guests that use EEG to drive some music and some synthesis process. So we will look into this aspect more deeply tomorrow at the same time. Another question for you, Nicolas, is what does it mean for AI production to be more realistic than realistic?
That is just because of my poor English. I mean, AI now, if you take the example of the Tacotron 2, developed by Google, they have shown in their paper from 2018 that the synthetic speech that was produced by the machine was judged by humans, as the real one. So this is a bit like, the Uncanny Valley. So now the simulation or the digital simulation are perceived as humans are really are. So that I wanted to express by saying that simulated reality could be even more realistic than the real one.
Thank you. Another question for all of you. It seems that there are two competing and antagonistic approach in AI and expert knowledge. We have an approach where expert knowledge is explicit, often in a logical form, and we have another approach of knowledge using data in an unsupervised way. Is it possible to integrate the both approach, integrate expert knowledge and deep learning, for instance, in order to go forward? Do you have an idea or some element of answer on that? Not really.
I do, but I always talk, so maybe I should.
Perhaps Rémi, because you have the two schemas, but is there a line of research that try to mix the expert approach in signal processing with data learning?
Yes, of course. We can make some assumption about the musical information, then we can make some manual choice before the training of the algorithm. So we can include some expert knowledge before the training based on data. For example, if sometimes the learning cannot make the good decision if it has too many information, too many input data. So we can make a human selection, manual selection about the suitable acoustic features. So yes, we can include human knowledge before the training.
Okay. Maybe I can add something. Yeah, there is a big trend these days to combine symbolic AI with connectionist AI to make them usable in industrial application. Mm-hmm. I mean, the output of neural networks can be sometimes out of control, so you never know in advance what will happen. And if you want to have a more expert control, you can import them in advance by using expert knowledge or to write rules to constrain what will happen in output of the system. So that's a big trend nowadays.
Okay, Nicolas, there is a more technical question about voice processing. Is it voice handled only as a sound, or can we integrate language? But I suggest that the guy that or the woman that asked this question just contact directly Nicolas Aubin. Aubin@irkam.fr, and is able to answer more in detail for the technical question. There is one question that is, for my point of view, very interesting. It's the idea that we are speaking about creativity and co-creativity between AI and human. But is there experience of co-creativity between humans, between several humans? And do we understand the same things for the co-creativity between humans and creativity between AI and humans? Do you have some questions? Do as composer or as teacher, do you find some heuristics in the interaction with other composers or the students in order to be more creative? Or is it a problem that appears only with machine?
I could jump in here just with a quick insight that the co-creative kind of chat bot that we're creating in your sketch, we're doing that informed by data that we've collected about how students collaborate with each other. So we actually created a chat environment for them to communicate with each other and collaborate with each other as they work on projects. And then we've analyzed all of those text interactions as they work together. And we're using that to inform what we're doing and how we're designing how they interact with an AI. So it's very much on our minds there. I'm not sure if that gets exactly to the question or not, but there's certainly, at least in our work, an intention to have those two things be parallel as much as possible.
Okay, thank you.
Jean-Louis,
yes?
I'd like to comment
please,
well, if I can. Yes. I just would like to discuss about, you know, a specific project on which I worked last year that was co-produced by IRCAM as well. The project is called Atlas. And in this project, we basically, we were three composers meant to design a co-creative performance in three cities to be played at the same time. So basically, the idea was that each one of us would co-create with the other ones and would co-play with the other ones. And it was an interesting experience for me. We ended up finding some methods to be co-creative. And it was very tough at the beginning, very difficult, in order to find a language, to find tools, and you know, and to share ideas in a constructive way. But I would say that after a number of weeks of work, we managed to find some methods. So I think that the question of being co-creative is a central question for musicians too, like for humans, I would say, not only for humans and machines. And so I think that I see in the future how composition could actually use co-creation. And I actually would be interested in doing more of these kind of experiences.
Okay, thank you. There are some signs in the audience, yes?
No, I was just going to say, from the field of education, there's significant research looking at how novices create together, because the reality in most classrooms are that there's not the technology nor the acoustic space for individual composing and creating and creative process with that. So from that point of view, there's actually quite a lot that, and I think there's some interesting insights to be gained from AI, particularly the need from that body of research for students who are co-creating together to be able to have their own private space to work out ideas and then bring that back together to the group. And there really aren't a lot of good tools out there that allow, a group composition to exist as well as a individual composition at the same time. And there's actually insights from managing major software repos and things like that that are starting to make their way into some of these creation environments that allow both kind of a group composition and then these individual spaces to create. So some interesting things from Ed as well.
Okay, thank you for all of you. There are other questions, but we have to shut down now the stream. So again, thank you very much for this discussion. Sorry for the technical troubles at the beginning. We are learning a lot, and I hope that tomorrow it will be more fluid and more easy, and the next time I'm sure also. Thank you again, and I hope to see you in person soon.